So how's everybody doing tonight?
Is this mine?
Yeah.
Is it?
That's yours, yeah.
I don't know how I feel about the temperature, though.
It's the temperature of this room.
So, way too hot?
Piss warm.
Piss warm.
It's cold.
It's cold?
It's colder than room temperature, but it's not cold.
Okay, cool. Who's ready to get into it?
I know I am.
All right. Let's do it.
Welcome back to episode 30. Holy shit. The big 3-0 of Wildly Adequate, the show about anything, everything, and usually nothing. I am 1/3 of your host and crew, Mr. Matthew Urso. And I am joined by, as always,
Patrick Fahim.
What do you say your full name?
Patrick.
Thank you. Mark.
Malcolm is again not here. He'll hopefully be back next week. Well, let's just jump right into it, boys. I'm starting today. It's been a while since
I call last.
Sure.
It's been a while since we have done
a game?
A good old fashioned tier list. Okay. So I present to you today a tier list. Now, the last time we did one of these was the chocolate tier list.
It was audio only, right?
I think that was a video episode.
It was audio.
We were in the basement. I remember this vividly. We were in his
chocolate tier list?
Yeah, we were in his basement.
It's been so long.
I'll have to get back.
Malcolm wasn't there, and we're just me and Matty in the basement.
You know how I know? I remember making the clip for that episode, and there was no video.
All right, screen is recording. Yeah. And I've done this in a way that's hopefully going to make my life editing later infinitely easier than it was in the past. Now, you might be asking yourself, what are we going to be ranking today on this tier list? It should be given away to you by the fourth level, which is different from last time where it was edible. It is now drinkable. That's right, bitches. We're ranking sodas.
All right.
It's a soda tier list.
But soda's so mid.
Soda's the best. Shut your dirty mouth. Let's begin. We begin, gentlemen.
Who decides?
Who decides what?
We're going to do it like the chocolate tier list.
Are we
going to
balance the vote, I guess?
No, we're not going to balance it. It's
2v1. But for chocolate, we did like... Didn't we do
if
like...
It was 2v1.
One person said A, one person said C, then we just go B?
No,
we never did that. Oh, you kept misunderstanding even during that topic.
Oh, so it's just like even if I say F and you guys both say A, it's A?
Then it's A, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's not representative of who we are.
If we all have three different answers, I think then we can try to come up with some sort of compromise. But to me, it's just a majority wins kind of
But how?
Thing.
Okay, what if he says A, you say B? Listen. What if you say A, he says B, I say D?
Mm-hmm. How? And or C would be the
so
most.
So you'd balance it.
Yeah, but that's if three different answers.
Yeah, but A and B are very close, is what I'm saying. So what if, for example, he said God tier, you said great, but I said dog shit? You'd put it on like in the middle? Because then that's balancing it, even though they're pretty much the same answer. God tier and great's very close. That's what
Bro,
I'm saying.
Bro, he's saying that if there's three different answers.
I know what he's saying, but I'm saying it doesn't necessarily make the most sense because, for example, great and good are pretty close. And if I say dog shit, then it bounces in the middle, but I think that should be consistent across.
If in that particular scenario, my opinion, it would just be good. It would just be
okay. Fine, we'll figure it out as we go.
Yeah.
So we begin with Orange Crush,
God tier for me.
Why is it I God tier?
They're all gonna pop up there, but we'll move it as we see fit. God. Where are we putting Orange Crush?
Orange Crush is my favorite soda, so I'm gonna go God tier.
It's a B tier for me. So good.
It's also God tier. So
God tier, right? That's your rule.
Listen, I was with you before.
What do you mean? You just said
I was
you criticized
just saying
me.
What he said, bro.
Yeah, you criticized me for it. So
now I have selected 15 different sodas.
Yeah.
Let me toss that out there. Now these first three are technically the same brand,
but
they're
flavors.
Different enough that I figured it made enough sense.
Can I just say, by the way,
please?
Let's say, for example, Patrick said he said good. I said God tier. But if me and Maddie said God tier and you said drinkable, then we'd have to put it at good, for example, or great. For example, it'd have to go down a little bit. You know what I'm saying? We can't do like two God tier and one dog shit and it stays at God tier. You know what I'm saying?
Well, that's to me why it's just the majority votes does it.
So then Patrick doesn't get...
I'm with you,
So then Patrick doesn't get represented
yes,
at all
I'm
in
with
that
Mark.
Vote?
I'm with
but
Mark.
This isn't what we... This was a whole thing throughout the entire chocolate tier list how it should
be figured
out.
But forget how we did the chocolate tier list. I'm saying like, do we want Patrick to be represented if he's outvoted? Or he's not represented at all if we put it as that God tier.
If we're going to do this list together, I should be partly represented. I agree with Mark.
You know what I'm saying?
So if Mark and I both say God tier and you say dog shit, where do we go?
I'd say at that point we either put it at great or good.
Like, it would be great or good, yeah.
Because there's two votes for God tier, so that weighs more than Patrick's vote. But
so probably great.
So then. What if it was great. God tier, great, and dog shit?
Then that'd be God good.
God tier, great, and dog shit?
I would say that's maybe about just good.
Keep it at, like, great or good?
So basically what we just said, if it was two God tiers or a...
If Patrick said Orange Crush is drinkable or dog shit, and we both said God tier like we did, I feel like it would be unfair to keep it at God tier, even though he said it's dog shit. You know what I'm saying?
You're a wise man.
We have to drop it one tier, for example.
Why are you flip-flopping on this? I gotta argue with two of you about this.
All I'm saying is that I feel like if the goal is to, like, push each other out of, just, like, you know, majority rules, and we'll do it like this. But if we want to have general representation of what we like, then we should, like, factor it in.
The reason why I was flip-flopping before is because your way is easier, but his way is more representative.
Sure.
Fine. So where are we putting Orange Crush?
To me, Orange Crush stays in this example because there's two votes for God tier, and he's at good. So
fuck you, Patrick.
So I don't think his doesn't weigh as enough to bring it down, is what I'm thinking.
Orange Crush, cream soda. Now, this could just be cream soda, the pop, but I went with Orange the Crush version of cream soda because I figured that's, you know, common enough. Everybody knows what's up.
No, I haven't had this in a very long time. Drinkable. I don't really remember. That's what I was going to say, drinkable for me, because I haven't had it in so long, and I don't remember it being horrible.
Cream soda is an easy great.
Okay, so we said drinkable.
So then good is in the middle.
So what do we say?
We'll do good.
But, I mean, is great, like, again, like, I was two away from God tier, and we didn't end up moving it. Matthew's two away from drinkable. Why would we move it up?
No, because me and you said drinkable.
Yeah.
He said great, so two votes weighs a little bit more than his one vote, so it should go down a little bit from great to good.
Okay, let me paint the picture one more time. Before, it was two of you at God tier.
Yeah.
And I was at good.
So we outweigh you.
Exactly. Right?
Yeah.
We didn't move even to great.
Oh, I see what you mean.
So now we're at drinkable, and he's at great. Okay. It's two difference. So we should keep it at drinkable, no?
No, we should... We should put Orange Crush at great if we're going to maintain cream soda being at good. If we're going to balance cream soda, we also have to balance Orange Crush. So we'd have to put Orange Crush at great. I thought that's what you were saying.
I thought we were going to use Crush as, like, the baseline, so we would keep Crush at drinkable. Cream soda at drinkable.
But then we're not factoring in Matty. We just said we're going to factor people in. What are you saying?
But you said before my good wasn't enough to, like, sway it. So then his great
now you make a good point of, like, your vote should be representative somewhere. You know what I'm saying? But my point was that two people said God tier, so it should stay at God tier.
Mm-hmm.
But let's say, for example, because you said good, we kept it at God tier. Let's say you said dog shit and we said God tier, then that would have to be factored in, I think.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to flip back to Matthew's side. Just keep majority rules.
So we're going to do it as drinkable then?
Yeah, let's just do
it. Even if Matty said God tier?
Even if Matty said
God tier. A crime against humanity.
Yeah, but then it's not even our tier list.
I know,
like,
but we're going to... The 90% of this topic is going to be us debating.
But or we could just decide a rule.
But what rule could we decide, like, without it being arbitrary?
The rule could be, for example, if... Majority picks one category, like, just God tier, like, two out of the three pick God tier, and one person picks lower than good, then it has to be factored in. If it's, like, more than two removed, for example.
Is that the rule then? More than two, then it has to get factored in? Okay, I'm okay with
that. You know what I'm saying? I'm just kind of throwing out an example.
Sure. Okay, let's do that. Let's see how it goes.
So, for example, God tier, we did two God tiers and one good.
Yeah.
So, good wasn't enough to drop it. If you said drinkable, then we'd have to drop it to great.
Okay.
So for Orange Crush, we said two drinkables and one
great.
Mm-hmm.
He's within two. He was at great.
So then it stays at drinkable. If you said God tier, we'd have to move it up. Mm-hmm. I think that's a fair system. Okay.
Grape Crush.
I don't even think I've ever tried Grape Crush, but I like grape flavored things, and I feel like I'd like it more than cream soda, so I'd put it at good.
I'm putting it at dog shit.
And this rule works really well. You know why? Because if you say drinkable, then you're right down the middle. We stay at drinkable.
Mm-hmm.
If you say good with me and Patrick's only two away, then we stay at good.
Mm-hmm.
If you say great, then we have to move it up past you know, drinkable.
Wow, you're taking a long
What did you say?
I said good and Patrick said dog shit?
Yeah.
So if I said great and you said good and Patrick said dog shit, it has to move because it's highest thing?
So how do we describe it?
You said
so,
if it's within two?
Yeah.
That was for a situation where it was two on one.
I guess we're saying if the extremes are within two? Or is that what we're saying?
Sure, we can say if the extremes
are. So, for example, dog shit, drinkable, and you said what? For example?
If I was going to say great, for example.
Okay, so then that means
Patrick's
so
at dog shit and you're at drinkable.
Good. No, I'm at good, sorry. So great, good, dog shit. Then I'd say we just balance it out at good.
I'm okay with that.
I'm going to say good anyways.
Okay.
So why is orange and cream soda a square and then crush is just like the water?
The PNG.
Next, from the fourth soda, Coca-Cola.
Okay, I'm going to be controversial on this one.
Yeah.
I'm going to say it's just good.
Really? I was going to say drinkable.
Drinkable.
Okay, so then in that case, drinkable. Because I'm only one tier off. I'm actually glad you guys said that because I was gonna say either drinkable or good, so I'm glad we settled there. It doesn't really do much for me.
Coca-Cola does nothing for me. Pepsi, speaking of drinks that do nothing for me.
To me, Pepsi is for me god tier with Orange Crush. I love it. And there's a strong difference between Pepsi and Coca-Cola for me. The Pepsi's a little bit sweeter, has more flavor to me, whereas the Coca-Cola sometimes feels just kind of flat. Not in terms of its carbonation, but in terms of its flavor, it just feels very dull. So to me, Pepsi and Crush are my only two favorite sodas. So I'm going to have to say God tier. When it comes to sodas, again, to me, yeah. Sodas to me have a low ceiling. I don't love them.
Yeah.
But if I had to rank sodas, that would be my favorite.
I'm just surprised that Coca-Cola and Pepsi are so extreme.
Well, but if you guys feel the same way about Pepsi than you do about Coca-Cola, then it might drop significantly. Then.
Dog shit, Pepsi.
Jesus Christ. What?
I mean, it's just one below Coke. But
okay, so
I'm going to say good. I'm going to go the other
Okay, then,
the other
then that's perfectly split into good then. Because I said God tier, he said dog shit, you said good. That's right down the middle. So Pepsi goes in good.
I suppose. Mm-hmm. Oops. God, Photoshop, you bitch.
I'm glad that Pepsi's above Coca-Cola at least. I'll take that. I'm a Pepsi man.
For our sixth one, mug
dog.
Root
dog.
Beer.
Dog. I don't think I've ever had it.
What do I say if I haven't had it?
You've never had root beer, any kind of root beer?
Not for Ever? Years. I don't even remember what it tastes like.
It's like a minty garbage taste.
All I know is
minty?
It's like a weird mint garbage
it's
taste.
It's not mint.
It's like along those lines.
Here's what I'm going to say. Not. I don't think any of these drinks to me are like, I'm going to throw up. So I'm just going to put it at drinkable.
I'm putting it dog.
It's
dog.
I will toss root beer down at drinkable.
Okay.
Okay. Drinkable. Mark, meet me a dog, please.
No,
meet me a dog.
I don't think it's dog shit though.
I can't stand.
I think that
stand for this.
But I think that root beer is just a personal preference thing, you know. And I think Matty has to be representative in this because he likes it more than we do. And
but
I don't.
If you went
I don't
dog,
really,
then.
Yeah, but I don't feel that strongly about it to put it at dog. So I'm not going to.
For our next soda, Sprite, baby.
God.
Here's the thing. I don't remember the last time I tried Sprite.
Don't blaspheme.
Listen, I don't remember the last time I've tried Sprite. I think I probably took a sip from you at some point when I was like really thirsty, and it's decent. I like it. It's good. I mean, I wouldn't choose it over any of the for Crush or Pepsi, but based on my limited experience with it, I'll give it a good.
You better say good.
Great.
Okay, so then it's then great? We're split at great. Then that's perfect. See, this rule makes sense to you. But do you see how good like and how representative it is? Because to me, it's like it's just decent. For me, it's good. For you, it's amazing, and for Matty, it's really good. So it's like we're gonna settle it really good. It's a fair system, I think.
I hate making lists, but I still despise it.
I hate making lists. With
I despise
fools.
It, and this is dumb, and I don't like it.
What? What are you talking about? Why?
I don't care about making the list representable. To me, it's just like
okay, well, just relax, it's chill.
If it's two votes for something, then it should just supersede that to me. And
yeah,
then
but
if
isn't
it's
that supposed
three
to be
split? Then it's a conversation.
But isn't that supposed
like,
to be our list? So, for example, if you put want some, if you two put something I got here, I put it a dog shit. Then it's not our list. It's you two with that decision, for example.
For that one.
But what if it happens three, four
vote,
times?
Sure.
What if it happens three, four times? And that means that half the list is fucking not representative of all three of us. So it's not even our list.
It could, I guess, but I just don't see the point in like. I see the point, but I don't get the like hang up of like it needs to represent.
It doesn't need to. I mean, if you're gonna be upset about it, it's not a big deal.
It's strange to
Let's
me.
Let's go to the next one.
Where the fuck are we? Dr. Pepper.
Dog shit.
Dog shit.
Really? Okay, good.
Fuck you, Dr. Pepper.
This is literally what was it? Ferrero Rocher all over again. How is Sprite not at God tier?
The problem with Sprite is there's more sodas on this that I'm going to put in the God tier category, which would be in my like top three, let's say, alongside Orange Crush. And Sprite just doesn't quite crack that for me. Which is why it doesn't deserve to be with the big boys.
Okay, we'll see.
If that makes any sense.
Yeah, okay, we'll see what you...
Mountain Dew.
Never had it.
Never?
I don't think so.
Ever?
I'm going to put it again.
The Baja. You had the Baja.
When did I have a Baja?
Baja Blast?
I don't remember that.
A while ago at the KFC.
I don't remember that.
You didn't have the Baja Blast?
I don't remember it, no. I mean, just, again, I'll put it on drinkable because I'm sure it's, like, fine.
It's a good for me. It's a good for me. A lot of sugar, but it's a good for me.
Mm.
70 grams, I think.
I'll go good. It's fine. It's not an affront to the senses like Dr. Pepper is, you know? Fanta.
Mm. To me, Fanta's great.
That's an orange drink.
It is.
To me, Fanta's great. I like Crush more because I don't like the super fruity flavor of Fanta, but I put it at great. I like it a lot.
It's good for me.
Fanta is also good.
Okay, so
because to me it's just less good Orange Crush, you know. Like it's if I'm gonna have an orange, well technically if I'm gonna have an orange pop, I want a Hank's, but that's a little more niche. No, that's a little more niche. But Fanta and Crush, like between the big two, is fucking. Crush, what are we talking about? Doritos, baby. Now I know Doritos have a wide selection of flavors, so I just went with Doritos the pop that you might find in a Mexican theme.
You're troublingly inconsistent here.
Why?
Crush has a wide range of flavors,
but
and you've
the only reason I went with the Crush cream soda and the Crush grape are basically just stand-ins for grape soda and cream soda.
There's a cream soda Doritos.
Well, now we've come at a problem, don't we? So other than cream soda Doritos, I'm talking about like mango, guava, pineapple.
So the tropical.
I don't think I've ever had that either. I don't think I've ever bought that before.
Have you ever been to Bar Burrito? Yeah, you have. It's the glass
bottle. I've seen it before, but I don't think I've gotten it before. There's the one that I used to get that was like an orange bottle, a glass bottle, but it wasn't Doritos. It was a different brand. I think Maddie knows what.
Are you sure?
Some other brand.
A glass bottle from where?
Island Soda?
Island Soda. That's the one I've tried. I haven't tried that.
Okay, well, I have.
So again, I've heard they're pretty good, so I'll settle in the middle for good.
They're great for me.
Okay.
Yeah. Good.
Okay, then we'll just stay at good then.
Okay. You don't like Doritos?
I do.
That's why you put it at good. He likes it.
These words are just that's C tier. That's B tier.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really, that's like, I guess if it's like a letter grade, like God tier is probably like an A plus, like A plus plus.
Yeah.
And then great is like, you know, around an A.
Yeah.
Goods around a B.
That's what I'm saying.
Drinkables are at a C. And then dog shit's a D.
Yeah.
So he gave it like a B. That's not bad.
It's not. Yeah, okay.
7-Up.
I don't think
what
I've
ever. What are you doing here?
What?
Okay.
Oh, it's 7-Up.
7-Up.
I'm going to go drinkable.
I'm going to go. I had it today at KFC.
Oh, you did?
That was the drink I had.
Was it good?
And?
It was good. It was fine. It was good.
Okay. Then good, right?
Good, yeah. We'll go good.
So you're both good.
It can't be the same as
Sprite. Oh, I was going to say drinkable, too.
Okay. Then we can settle it.
To me, 7-Up's problem, similar to Fanta, is that it's just like poor man's Sprite,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Again, I don't think I've ever had 7-Up, but I'm not a big fan of that type of soda.
The way I think of it with some of these is if I was at a birthday party or a shindig of some kind, and I was like, hey, can I get a drink? And they're like, yeah, we've got soda and shit. And I'm like, what do you got? And they're like, here's a 7-Up. Like, there's a slight
disappointment. Judge them.
Yeah, there's a judgment. Just throw it in their face. There is a judgment and a slight disappointment, you know? Same with a Fanta, where I'd be like...
Say that you would judge them.
I would judge them. Okay. But it's like Fanta, you couldn't just shell out for fucking Orange Crush. Like, so there is a bit of a judgment call
it's
here.
It's like if you ask for a Kit Kat and they give you a 4-Fun.
Oh, my God.
You know what I'm saying? 4-Fun's good, though. Patrick likes the 4-Fun.
4-Fun was... Four Fun was pretty
or
bad.
If you, they said, hey, do you want a Kinder? And then they handed you a Bueno.
A Bueno, sure. I remember when we tried the 4-Fun and we were like, this is better than I could have sworn we were like, holy shit, this is way better.
You
so
said
good.
That. I remember yeah. you said
no,
that.
You, I remember you trying it and you were like, that's really
good. It was
good.
Yeah, it was good. Definitely was
you're
good.
Downplaying it. You're downplaying it.
We come to the last three here.
Okay.
Schweppes.
Never tried it. I've never tried so many of these. That's a ginger ale?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Well, they have like peach and cherry and stuff.
Too. I was
thinking specifically the ginger ale.
The ginger ale.
Okay, here's the thing. Like in the
it's
case,
just
in,
average.
In the case of the ones I haven't tried, if you guys want to not count me, that's fair. But like again, I'll just probably go drinkable because I've never.
I'm going good.
Here's what I'm gonna say. I'm gonna say it from the heart.
Okay.
I think the reasonable part of my brain, and I think I can be reasonable, would put Schweppes at good. However,
I know exactly what you're going to say.
I consider it more than the Fanta, more than the 7-Up, an insult to the far superior brand that it's trying to
represent. I'm sure we're going to come up on it.
Which, buckle up for the next one. So to me, because of the insult and because of the amount of times in my life I've been disappointed when somebody says, do you want a ginger ale? And I go, yes. And they hand me a Schweppes. Schweppes for me is dog shit.
Oh my God. Wait. What did you say, Patrick? Good?
I said good.
So then we'll just balance it at drinkable, I guess.
Purely for the insult that Schweppes provides. Mm. Speaking of ginger ale.
Canada dry.
Canada motherfucking dry, baby. God.
I can't believe you couldn't reciprocate my Sprite God. I'm about to give you this
Canada dry. I've never tried it. I swear to God, I've never tried
Canada
it.
Canada dry?
I've never tried it.
You're bullshit.
I swear to God. Whenever I go to a fast food place and I get a combo, I get either one of the orange drinks like Fanta or Crush.
Yeah.
Or I just get a Pepsi. Or iced tea if I go to a restaurant or something, but I've never tried a ginger ale. I will.
You should.
You guys, I mean, yeah, believe it or God tier because I have no say on it, but yeah.
But here's the thing, because you said you're giving me God tier for ginger ale, my favorite soda, and I couldn't give it to you for Sprite. Notice, though, that I couldn't give it to you for Sprite, that even begrudgingly you know you have to give it to ginger ale.
I'm not doing it begrudgingly. I love Canada Dry.
But doesn't that tell you something?
What does it tell me?
Canada Dry's the shit. We come up to the last one. This is technically the one wild card, I guess, that exists. So this was a purely personal one. Guaraná, the Brazilian fucking pop.
God.
That Patrick and I are both big fans of. And if you haven't tried it out there, do yourself a favor. Get your hands on it.
Never tried it.
Somewhere.
Never tried it?
An ethnic grocery store or something.
We all tried it. He brought it for us. Okay,
but let's say I had one sip a year or two. I don't remember what it tastes like. I have no idea what it tastes like.
Quick, what did you eat 365 days ago? Go.
Yeah.
Go.
Ready? Go.
Well, fellas, that was it. That's all.
Okay.
Honestly, looking at the list, I feel like it's pretty decent. I mean, there's nothing to me where I'd strongly disagree with
it. You know what's funny?
Mm.
Is the majority of our chocolate list didn't look anything like this.
Mm.
The majority of pops are just mediocre because like as drinks,
yeah,
soda is mediocre.
But
I don't know if you guys disagree, but like looking at the list, it's like I feel like it's a pretty good indication of what we like. I think for me, for myself personally, like maybe Fanta would be a little higher, but other than that, it's pretty spot on.
For me, Sprite would be God tier. Mm.
But like I'm content with where it's at.
I'm okay with where it's at.
Do any of you guys have any like strong objections? Like, there's no way this should be in this category at all.
The only egregious one to me is I would put Crush,
which one,
the cream soda, or just cream sodas generally to me is a great soda. Oh. That's my only like.
Hmm. I think if me and Patrick were like cream soda people, then we'd probably be up there for sure.
But we're both not cream soda people.
Is there anything I missed? Because I did do some thinking when I was putting this together today of like. Sodas I missed. I know there's like a Long Island or like Jones, but I guess technically you could make the argument for Doritos.
Is that not carbonated, is it?
No. Because like I didn't do a Long Island or like a Jones sodas because to me those are like.
You didn't do any of like the diets. Like diet.
Yeah, color. And then I could have gotten into what like about, diet things, but even I'm not super familiar with
what
those.
What about any of like the. Isn't it like red sodas? Like. Fucking like cherry soda, and I've never tried those sort of things.
Well, Guananas cherry.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But isn't Dr. Pepper cherry too? No. Or is Dr. Pepper something else?
It might be. Dr. Like Pepper's minty. A medicinal.
What is with you and minty? The only thing that comes to mind now actually would be Chubby.
I have no idea.
Oh, yeah. Like, you know, where it comes
like a little bottle. Like it's a stout, fat little bottle. And I always used to get the cotton candy one because they used to have it at the dollar store.
Oh, I remember.
So that
you said cotton candy in it.
But even that's not like again
you
I
hit
know
the
I,
big boys
I put Doritos on there, which technically is a range of flavors, so by that logic maybe I should have put Jones and Long Island and some
but,
of these
but
other
but the problem with what you're saying is that Canada Dry has a range of flavors.
Yes,
Pepsi has a range of flavors,
sure, but there's one key one, like there's not one key
Doritos.
Long Island or even Doritos again. So I know it's not the most consistent thing, but there's to me Doritos just made more sense as like a line of pops because it's these more like tropical flavors.
Dude, this takes me back. I used to love the orange Chubby.
Oh, fuck yeah,
oh,
baby.
Oh, wow, yeah, I remember these.
Remember things. That? That shit was good.
I hated those things.
Really?
Yeah. Those were so garbage.
Yeah.
They hated you.
Yeah.
That went right down the wrong pipe. Well, anyways.
Oh, yeah. I don't think we're missing anything. We got the big boys. We got the big names.
I think so.
Okay. Stop watching now. Actually, I'm just kidding. We're going to talk about two more topics.
There he goes.
Matthew's dying.
So I was watching an Instagram video today, and it was like this, I guess you call it like an emulator. Is that what it is? Where it's like a little a Game Boy looking device.
Right. And you can have one on your computer.
Yes. Yeah. And it has like, so he showed it. It's like, it looks like a Game Boy, but it has like a newer screen. So it's like higher definition. And it has like 2,000 games downloaded on it or whatever.
I think I know what you're talking
about. And it has an HDMI cord plug-in. So you can plug it into your TV and it plays like really high resolution on your TV. You can play SNES games. You can play N64 games. You can play PS1. All these games. And he said it's like really high quality. I was watching this review and I'm like, I want to buy this thing. I click on the link and it's only like $25 USD. So Canadian, you'd probably be like, you know, probably pay around like what, 40 something?
Yeah.
With something shipping like and whatever. So I'm like, I want to get this thing. So I wanted to talk about like our favorite handhelds ever.
Ooh.
Like, you know, think about growing up. Think about the one that, you know, impacted you the most. You used it the most often at school with friends. I can start if you guys don't mind. I remember there was a period of time where like in school, the Nintendo DS was just fucking like insanely popular. I mean, we'd show at sometimes we'd have like a fun day or whatever.
Mm.
And everyone would come in with the DS and everyone was playing Mario Kart together. Like playing battle mode with the balloons or whatever. And it was just like, so much fun. And then I'd play like Smash Brothers and then I'd play, you know, I don't know. It was just, I love the DS. You guys ever played WarioWare? That's a really fun game.
No, but like I know the WarioWare
games. Basically like, it's basically like random mini games and it's like Wario themed or whatever, but it'll be like a quick time event or you have to like snap these three balloons in within 2 seconds or whatever, and it's like a fun mini game thing.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, and Kirby, I love Kirby. So like the DS was big for me, but to me, I think ultimately my answer for like best overall handheld is probably the PSP.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to go with the PSP. Just the amount of times I was playing like Battlefront and just like, it was amazing. Love it.
Do you ever play Invisimals?
I remember that shit. You see it with like a hologram or whatever.
Yeah, you need the placemat thing.
Yes.
That was a crazy game.
Invisible.
But it was really short.
I never.
There was a story mode. It was like really short.
Mm.
Patricia.
What? Yeah. Would I thought you were gonna add on to Invisibles.
Not an Invisibles person.
You never played Invisibles ever?
No.
You know what I remember? I remember being at a wedding and playing it. It was like some family friend's wedding, and I was like a little kid. I was like, you know, 8 or whatever, and I was just playing.
I remember what I remember about Invisimals is they had these like series of like rare dragons that you could collect. Do you remember that?
Not really.
No?
No.
There was like the dragons, but then there was like the tiger shark. That was the cover animal. You remember?
If I saw the images, I'd be like, holy shit.
Yeah.
But I just remember there was like a visual aspect to it, right? You have to like look through the thing, and you like, isn't there something where you like, It's like a hologram type shit, no?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
But you can like look through the DS and
yeah, you look through it and you can see it. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, cool. Yeah. I remember that blew my mind.
No, not the DS, the PSP.
I'm sorry, the PSP.
Yeah, you needed the camera extension.
Oh yeah, it wasn't the original PSP. Then it was the.
No, you could use it on the original.
It was on the original.
You could have used it. Yeah.
Because I remember at some point I had a PS Vita. My dad just brought one home from the airport. Some guy left it and never came back. And the Vita was pretty cool. I don't know why we got rid of it, but like it was pretty cool.
Yeah.
And there's like one cool feature about the Vita, which I didn't really end up using very much, but it was a neat idea, was like the whole back was like this glass touchscreen thing.
Yeah.
So you could like play games and they'd incorporate it in the back. Like you swipe to do something. You're just like holding it. So you don't have to like move your hand. And it's like it's very comfortable and you just swipe. Or
that's cool. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I mean, I respect the choice of PSP. I respect it, but ultimately you touched on it and DS is the correct answer for this question.
It's so tough, bro.
It was so ubiquitous. I said that word so weird.
Ubiquitous.
Ubiquitous. It was so ubiquitous.
Honestly, like the more I think about it, the more I'm like, I played more games on the DS. I spent more time on the DS.
I spent so long on the DS, whether it was Super Mario 64, whether it was Diddy Kong Racing, whether it was Pokemon.
Oh, Pokemon, yeah. I didn't play it much, but I remember playing a little bit of it, and it felt so exciting.
Just Pokemon
like
was
collecting different Pokemon.
Pokemon, by far, like, it is a game that I foresee myself playing into my late years of adulthood as well. Like, I don't think I could ever get sick of that.
They're always
coming
out with new ones, and you know, people play them on the Switch and stuff. I hope Nintendo comes out with a new console. Because I know a lot of people are shitting on the Switch for being like way too dated.
The rumor has it that at Gamescom like a month or two ago that Nintendo was apparently showing something off behind closed doors to like developers. Mm. So there's been years for, or there's been years. There's been years. Rumors. There's been rumors for years now that they're doing another console. I imagine it's going to be like a Switch 2 of sorts because the Switch has been so successful that why fuck with that?
But the anyways. Only thing that is wrong with the Switch if they can address is just it's so weak as like a console.
Like it's like frail?
No, no, no. Like physically weak. Like so like performance-wise weak.
Like it's Overwatch, basically like a PS4 kind of not even. In a box.
Because even like Mortal Kombat's
when the hell are you talking about?
It the games it runs on there are like PS3, PS4 games. Like I'm saying it's like an early like 2013 PS4 level hardware.
My PS4 downstairs was a 2013 PS4 and it played all the PS4 games smooth.
Yes.
You cannot play Overwatch on a Switch.
It's not the same, but what I'm saying is it's like it's comparable, like it's in that.
I cannot stand for this comparison.
Ballpark of consoles.
I cannot stand for this comparison.
I'd say for me, because I remember when the PS4 came out, remember Infamous Second Son? That game still looks incredible. Mm-hmm. So like I'm sure that the Switch can never handle anything like that. So my assumption is that it's more like Xbox 360 or PS3 type handling of games. But I don't know.
It would be closer to that.
Or maybe it's just because of the different, like, I mean, I know that, you know, there's like Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild, and the new one too. So like it can handle big games for sure. But I guess it's like the type of graphics.
Yeah, it's just their stuff. They have to do it more sneakily where it's like, yeah, Tears of the Kingdom and Breath of the Wild, I would argue both look fantastic and whatever, but it's like they're doing the like cel shaded, like kind of art style where it's like, yeah, you're not gonna get Ghost of Tsushima running on fucking the Switch or whatever kind of thing. But anyways, we're getting off track.
Aside from the power, I like the Switch through and through is a great console. I kind of feel,
you know, you could answer Switch by the way because it is a handheld in a sense. You can make it a handheld.
I can't. I'm
not just saying you could. I'm not saying like you should. But I'm just saying.
I'm not even leaning towards it. But I was just gonna say like I have a Switch, but I feel like it's so underutilized. Like I've underutilized it. Mm.
I'll throw in one more before Matty goes as well. Okay. To me, I think when I think of my childhood, I think when I was thinking overall. I may say DS, but when I'm thinking about my childhood, I think it's got to be the Game Boy Advance SP.
Really?
It's this little, you know, little square one, and you flip it, and like you could have a little light that you hook on it. I play at night with a little light. I played this really cool. I guess it was a little bit before our time, or maybe like you know when we were like little kids, like really
was
little.
Was it
kids.
The two button?
Yeah, yeah. And it had like the little D-pad, and then it had like the A and B or whatever, and then select, start.
Yeah, my friends had it, but I never had it.
I remember playing like an X-Men game on there. I still have yet to figure out what the name of the game is, but I love that game. Mm-hmm.
Oh my God.
Incredibles, I'd play on there.
Speaking of Marvel PSP, Marvel Ultimate Alliance, I spent hours on that too.
Yeah. You know what's interesting about the DS is that you could play Game Boy games in there.
Mm.
That's what I remember. That's why I think.
Yes, I did not know. I have owned a DS for so years. Mm. For so years. Jesus Christ, what is wrong with
me? Even the one in 3DS, no?
3DS, no, doesn't have it. But the standard DS I've had for so many years. And, like, I did not realize until, like, I swear to God, a couple of years ago that, like, the back thing is basically just a Game Boy cartridge that pops out and you can put Game Boy games. Yes. I was like, what the fuck is this? So I was like, I never realized that.
So I think factoring that in, DS is definitely my answer because it had, like, some of my favorite games from Game Boy I can just plug in.
You can't change your answer.
I'm changing it.
You can.
I've already changed it.
With regards to handheld consoles, I love a good handheld console. It's definitely something that I wish, well, we'll get to Sony, would take a little bit more seriously in this modern day and age.
Like PlayStation.
PlayStation.
Why would they take it seriously? Why would they when the Switch is
because
is the thing.
The Switch is doing it for them.
My attitude is the Switch is so successful that to me it indicates that.
So successful? What do you mean by so successful?
It was incredibly successful.
One of the highest selling consoles of all time.
Where on the list is it?
I've been screen recording this whole time. Whoops.
Yep. I think it's like, I had to guess, it's probably
PS2
like
PS2 is still the highest.
I'm guessing it's like third, for example.
Highest selling console.
Okay, Patrick, put in your guess. I'm saying three.
No, I'm saying console
six.
Games.
Six. I guess a six.
Best-selling game consoles. PS2 at three, one, baby. DS, and then Switch at three currently. But the Switch is going to probably... I mean, it depends when they announce the next Nintendo thing
how
and how...
PS2 still number one?
PS2, by the way...
PS2 is insane.
PS2 is, like, my favorite console.
Consoles will have to be a separate thing one day.
Oh, I fucking love
the PS2.
PS2,
what helped it out so much at the time is that it can play DVDs. Mm-hmm. So when it came out, the reason it did so well was because, obviously, so many people bought it for, like, video games. But a lot of people back in the day were like...
Movies?
Oh, like, this thing's cheaper than some DVD players and it plays video games? Like, I guess I'll just pick this up for my, like, these newfangled DVDs, you know, at the time.
See, the Game Boy Advance is up there. It's number, like, what, 9 or something?
The Advance is, well, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
And it came out in 2001, but the one I had wasn't called the Game Boy Advance. It was called the Game Boy Advance SP. Which was like a couple years after. So, but you could see what I'm saying when I'm saying it's before our time. In terms of like 2001, we were 1 year old. We were 1 year old.
I wonder what the worst one is. Oculus Quest. Well, that's not Oculus's fault. It's a fucking VR thing.
What else is up there? It's incredible that DS is number two.
What makes me happy is that Xbox is consistently lower than PlayStation. Its PlayStation counterpart.
Yes, the PlayStation 3, 2, 3, and 4 are above it. But also, where is the 5? Oh, 5 is quite low, I guess, because of the shortages that they had and stuff.
5? Yeah, 5 for now is low, but 5 is the 5 is on track, if the numbers keep going, to wind up higher than even like PS4 did. Assuming it stays on track.
It's going
to
triple?
Track. Because PS4 was 2013, so it's 10 years in, and it's at that. And
yeah, but
the PS5 is only 3 years in, and it's already at, basically, let's say 42.
Yeah, but what proportion of the PS4 sales were like within the first couple of years? Or was it like a steady increase? Because I doubt like as many were sold in 2018 as were in 2014.
I'd have to go look and see like a year breakdown of it. We'd have to consult the data. Because
I feel like at this point, I mean, the PS5 has been out for what, like 2 years now? Or 3 years?
This December will be 3 years.
Yeah, 3 years. And if it's at 41, I don't
see
it. Well,
put it this way. By the end of this year, it's going to sell a shitload more because Spider-Man. Christmas 2 and Spider-Man 2, or Christmas 2. Jesus Christ, what the fuck is wrong with me today? Did I have a mental fucking breakdown and I didn't know about it? I can't speak. I'm sorry. Christmas and Spider-Man 2 is going to be a big bump it for this year.
You think it could Christmas time and Spider-Man coming out at the same time is going to like double the sales?
How do you guys feel about getting me a PS5 for Christmas?
Ooh. Not good.
You guys feel good about it?
I don't feel good about that.
You split it four ways.
Honestly, can we also
split it four ways?
Can we also acknowledge the Wii? The Wii came in strong.
Insane.
Did better.
Why are we switching to consoles, bro? This guy didn't even say his favorite handheld.
Okay, that's right. I'm sorry.
It's okay. We'll get to consoles one day. With regards,
so get this list out. Get this list out.
We'll get. How about this? How about you pull up? Can you pull up like a best selling handhelds?
Yes, highest selling handheld
console of all time. Here we go.
Well, yeah, the DS is number one.
So let's see the list here.
No, that's the same.
Oh, interesting. It's not. Fucking wiki page. Can you open a different link? Maybe it's a different. It'll be a different page.
Best-selling handheld consoles,
video game wikis. Okay, so the DS, then the Nintendo Switch.
Yeah.
Then the Game Boy Color, 1989 to 1998. That's pretty old.
And
PlayStation
then
Portable.
PSP.
That's the PSP. Okay.
Four.
Game Boy Advance.
Nintendo. The Vita. Sega. Nokia, green.
So we can clearly see that Nintendo's dominating the space. Like, that's what they do.
It's their thing.
And this is the thing, which, you know what, we'll save this. Let me just get into the actual handheld itself. Purely on, like, the one I've used the most and have spent the most time with, it would
be
the Switch. Yeah. If I had to pick an answer, though, I would go PSP. Because as a kid, my DS, the problem with handheld gaming with me is that when I had a DS and a PSP and was playing them a lot, it's not when I was like as into games in quotes as I am now and had the money to like just buy shit whenever I wanted. So my DS, for all intents and purposes, was basically just a Mario Kart and new Super Mario Brothers machine. Like, that's all I used it for because I'm not a Pokemon guy. So taking it, like, I remember as a kid going on like hockey tournaments and, you know, when we'd have the away ones in like hotels and stuff and everybody had their DSs and like running Mario Kart parties and shit and like the races and all that, like that was so much fun. But other than what's
you're being ridiculously biased right now.
Why?
You just admitted that Switch is what you use the most.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the question but you're wasn't
pick
the,
Sony.
The question wasn't saying, which one you use the most. Which one's your favorite of all
if
time?
If I like, yeah, to me, it's if I'm saying more like the Switch would probably be like my favorite handheld for a bunch of reasons. But I'm saying like just to kind of do something a little more nostalgic and kind of like what's in my heart is the PSP. I can still remember getting my PSP. I don't think at the time when I got it, I even knew it existed. Mm. Maybe I did, but if memory serves, like when I was fucking 5 or 6 or whatever, well, when was the PSP? 2004. What? So yeah, like 5 or 6. I don't even think I knew it existed. Because I remember it was the very first time we went to Portugal, my parents and my brother and I. And because it's like an 8-hour flight and shit, and my parents were like, well, this 4-year-old and 2-year-old are going to lose their fucking mind on like an 8-hour flight. We've got to get them something to entertain themselves. And by that point, we had been like, it was either when our uncle had given us his PS2 or like for sure at that point was when it was still his. But every time they came over, he'd bring it and like we'd all sit around and like play the Jaws game or the Godzilla game or fucking God of War.
Have you played Jaws Unleashed?
You should. It's bitch. Amazing.
PS2 game. Just play. You play as the shark and you just kill 50 people. So fun. You like leap through the water and bite boats and shit. It was so sick.
There's a boss fight against a killer whale.
See, I don't think I ever played the game. So many games I played as a kid, I'd play like the first 5-10 minutes and I just loop it. And then and then I wouldn't be able to get past a certain point. I wouldn't care to get past a certain point.
That's such a like little kid thing.
Yeah.
But I can remember clear as day my parents like putting the PSP in the box on the kitchen table, and it was the one that came packed in with Daxter, spinoff of Jack and Daxter, which was like a PSP launch game, and just like having it and being like, what the fuck is this? And just this whole like mind-blowing thing of like, wait a minute, you mean to tell me that I can take a PlayStation, but it's like tiny and I can take it with me? And then playing Daxter was so much fun, and that was a console that I like got more games for like from Christmases and birthdays. Like I remember playing like Medal of Honor games on there, or like NHL 07, and that was a game where like on tournaments and stuff, like there would be other people with PSPs who would have NHL 07, and then we would be like wirelessly playing together, which also at that point was like
unbelievable.
Yeah, of like we're playing over the internet, like what even is the internet? The PSP God of War games, the 2 God of War games they made, too, are like...
Isn't the one where he's, like, chained up is, like, the image for one of them?
Yeah, because one of them, it's Chains of Olympus and Ghost of Sparta, the 2 games. Mm. And I just remember, like, being into God of War so much as a kid. And, again, like, having these spin-off-y kind of, like, PSP ones.
Uncharted. It
was just, I think Vita was the Uncharted Vita. Game, Golden Abyss. That's the thing, is I never had a Vita. I would like to get one eventually, maybe for like a select handful of games. But anyway, so I'm gonna go PSP, but this gets to my broader point about handheld consoles. I wish the Vita had gone better for Sony than it did, because the Vita was kind of like a bit of a bungle.
The Vita was in a lot of ways equivalent to the Wii U.
Where is it on the list here?
Down it's like middle here. Yeah, pretty much middle of the pack.
I mean, it came out in 2012, so it came out in a time, it seems like, I guess it was overshadowed by the PS4, because the PS4 came out like a year and a half later. And
yes,
I mean, I'm sure they didn't market it as good as they should have or take it as seriously as they should have, but I guess they were like, it seems like based on the release date that they had like a smaller team working on that, but like the main team has been working on the PS4. Right?
Yes. The Vita's problem is it's just, yeah, it was weird for a lot of reasons. Like with the PSP, for example, I think it has the advantage of being the first PlayStation like handheld, but it's like PS2 was 2000, PSP was 2004. So for 4 years, it's like, okay, I've got my PS2, I'm playing all these incredible games, blah, 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 blah. And then like halfway through or a little over halfway through the generation, they're like, hey, here's PS2 kind of like on the go. And you were getting like the PSP God of War games are on par in a lot of ways with like God of War 1 and 2 on the PS2. So it was like comparable shit.
Imagine if they did like a PlayStation Portable 3.
Oh my God.
Where they had like, I mean, obviously they can't match the power of a full on PS5, but if it was like even close, like just, exactly. Just like the Vita was comparable to the thing. So imagine if you could play like a fucking 4K game on your PS, and it's like a decent sized screen. You could play like the new Mortal Kombat, and it looks like 4K crisp.
I would never want to play the new Mortal Kombat on a handheld device.
I mean, I'd prefer, but then there are certain games where, like, if you're out of the house, and let's say, for example, like, you're bored somewhere, or if you're taking public transport, or you know, you're going on a family trip and you're in the back or whatever, and you're just like, anytime you're going to be like bored, you pull that thing out and you have an excellent experience. Obviously, you're always going to prefer a big TV. But at the same time, there are some games that are really well tailored to portable.
To me, that's why I love the Switch so much, because the Switch basically became like my indie machine, where it's like 90% of the indie games I play on Switch, because I don't mind playing
lower res and
not even that much, but especially even if it's like a pixel art game, for example, like I don't mind playing Celeste on the Switch, because it's like, okay, it's this like 2D platformer kind of thing that it's like I don't need the giant TV and whatever to see it on. Like, I don't mind it on a smaller screen. But the Vita, yeah, it also didn't help that Sony, like, kind of abandoned it after a few years, where they, like, stopped really focusing on it that much.
And then they killed it at some point pretty early.
And then, yeah, and then now they've totally abandoned it, like, development and all that. The other thing is, I think the store on it is still open, but I know they had announced they were closing it, but I think people kind of pushed back and now it's still open, but eventually they'll fucking
What's sad is that the Vita itself is actually like, the UI is really cool and it just looks very like, it looks like the PS, I guess 3 home screen with like all the bubbles and stuff. And I remember it looking pretty cool and the I was like, I like this.
PSP, well, this is what's interesting too with the Sony handhelds, is that the PSP's UI was basically the PS3.
It's the squares.
Yeah, like before the PS3 was out kind of thing. Whereas, and even the Vita was the same way, where the Vita like kind of has a PS4 look to it in some ways a year before the PS4 was out. So there is like that neatness to it, but
it felt like a good this is a Sony, this is like a PlayStation machine.
Yes,
it's not just some like weird thing that they just like didn't really give a shit about. I mean, maybe they didn't, but like, I mean, it wasn't just like a weird side thing. It was like, it felt like within the family of PlayStation, it felt like a high quality thing like a PlayStation is. Yeah, but you know what's interesting about handhelds to me is like, I feel like everybody has two favorites, like one that's like the best you've ever played. So like, I think it's pretty irrefutable that the Switch is the best handheld that's ever been created, just because it's like the most recent, best technology for a handheld, whatever. So I think everyone who's played it has to admit that it's like probably the best they've ever played. But in terms of like your favorite, nostalgia plays a role in that. And you can even say consistency, if you feel like one of the other devices was more consistent than the Switch. But I feel like for me, again, like the best I've ever played is probably the Vita, but it's not my favorite. You know, so I think there's like two different categories there.
What was I gonna say? But yeah, so that's the thing where it's just I wish Sony would just try another handheld, truly, because I'll get to what they're doing. Almost even if it doesn't work, I would just like to see them compete with Nintendo. Because the problem is Nintendo since 2017, practically, with the Switch being out, has had no. Like,
no reason to try to up themselves.
Serious competition. That is changing, and that's what I kind of wanted to get into too really quickly, is I think what's interesting is the way or where handheld gaming is going, because it's like you have the Switch, which is basically at its tail end, so Nintendo's going to do something next. PlayStation is doing this PlayStation Portal thing, which is
Is this an official handheld thing?
They're handheld in quotes, which is basically just a PS5 controller with a screen thrown in the middle of it.
This is, but you were saying you wish they were going to do a handheld, but they are doing a handheld?
The problem with this thing is it's a remote play device.
So it's just for connecting
to your PlayStation? So it's for like connecting to your PS5 and streaming PS5 games.
What's the problem with that?
To your thing. I think it is interesting. The problem with cloud streaming and like remote play is that it's so Wi-Fi dependent,
input lag and whatever.
And input lag, because I even like have tried remote playing shit just to try it like on my phone or computer, like, just because you can Bluetooth a PS5 controller to your phone or computer, and like if you were gonna play, you know, some turn-based whatever game where there's not a lot happening, it's fine. But to try and play something that is way more labor intensive, it just doesn't work. So like, even with this PlayStation Portal thing, if it was like, hey, it's remote play, plus you can natively download shit to it and not play over the internet, that would have me way more interested.
Is that not what they're doing?
If you told me, I think it's just like remote play, basically.
Why would they not consider...
This is a question for Sony. Because if you told me, like, hey, get a like slightly lesser version of, you know, fucking Spider-Man or whatever playing on this thing. It's like,
can you?
I would probably get it.
You know that third image up there? Mm. You click that one. Can you click on the link? I want to see what they're saying about it. It's like, this is like on PlayStation's website.
PlayStation Portal remote player.
Yeah, remote.
For PS5. Available November 15th. Technology.
Okay, PlayStation Portal remote gives you access to games on your PS5 over your home Wi-Fi, letting you jump right into gaming without needing to play on a TV. Wait, so if you're not, you have to be at home?
No, this is the thing. Technically, you could be out. Yeah, it's just like, because you can remote play on your phone from wherever, but the problem is it's the same thing where it's like, it depends on your home Wi-Fi, and then at that point, it also depends on the Wi-Fi of like wherever you're at kind of thing.
Yeah, so you have to have Wi-Fi in wherever you are, plus your home Wi-Fi. This feels like
it's bound to fail.
Beautiful 8-inch.
Because why?
60 frames, 1080p, that's pretty cool.
Which to me is perfect, because 1080 is fine.
How often do you find yourself in a place with such strong Wi-Fi that it makes sense to use this?
This is the problem. And I get the way it's kind of being marketed.
How much is it, by the way? Can you click the pre-order now?
I want to say it's like $200. Well, that's American, so there you go. $270 for Canadian.
That's wild. I'm not gonna, who's going to pay $300 for just a fucking extension of your PS5?
And this is the thing where, like, some people, even the PlayStation show I like, shout out Sacred Symbols, has, like, made the argument of, like, if you're at a place where, like, you're at home and you're, like, married and have kids, and you don't always have access to, like, the TV that your PS5 is hooked up to, for that particular use case,
it's so niche, though.
This is useful of, like, all right, like, my kids are using the TV, let me sit in the living room with them, and I have the PS5 in my hands, basically. So I get that, but that's the problem, is it's more of, like,
convenience,
a very specific circumstance to have this thing, as opposed to, like, a new handheld.
If it was like $100 like bucks or $200 maybe.
I feel like they could have made a new handheld that has this capability.
Well, that's to me where it's like, I don't get why they wouldn't have designed it of like, hey, it's a streaming play, like remote play thing, and it downloads shit natively. Like all digital, obviously, because they're not going to be making fucking cartridges or whatever.
I think it looks cool, and I like the idea of just using the controller side, like the side, the kind of arms of the controller.
Very Switch-esque.
Yeah, oh yeah, that's true. And then also, because I love the PS5 controller is the best controller I've ever used, and it feels perfect in my hands, so having that is a good idea.
And it's got the like haptic feedback and cool. The triggers and all that shit that the PS5 controller already has, it's like...
But what's frustrating about that is like, it seems like it has potential to be like really good, especially with like the screen quality and whatever. Like, why are they not going all in on it?
It's a half step, which is what's frustrating. So on the Sony side of things, handheld gaming frustrates me. Xbox, I don't think, is ever going to dip their toe in. They're having enough fucking trouble with Xbox as it is. Nintendo's going to do probably Switch 2. The Steam Deck seems to be the biggest player in the handheld space as of late, of like, hey, take your entire PC library on Steam and it's handheld now. Apparently, it's really good, and especially because, like, Sony, for example, has ported, you know, The Last of Us Remastered and God of War to, like, Steam. Like, there's PC versions, so technically you can play God of War on a Steam Deck.
That's cool.
Portably kind of thing, wherever you want. So I think Steam Deck's really interesting. All the, like, emulator things and retro kind of handhelds I think are neat, too. It's interesting to see what Apple's going to do with the new iPhone, the 15 or whatever, which is just coming out, where like their whole thing at their conference for it was like Death Stranding and I forget what the other big game, Resident Evil 4 remake, are going to run on the iPhone 5, like natively at 6K
15
or 4K and 60 FPS and all that
shit.
What
the fuck?
iPhone 15?
Yeah.
That's wild.
So dude, it's that, like,
eat your battery in like a minute, because Death Stranding is like a PS5 exclusive game. It's like 4K. Wasn't it? Or is it PS4?
It was PS4. Yeah, because it was... Yeah, it's PS4, but it's on PS5, like the upgraded version.
I gotta play that game again. Anyways. I didn't really give it a fair shot.
But it's like, so it's interesting to see Apple kind of dipping their toe in of like, basically, not like the iPhone 15 obviously isn't a handheld console, but like trying to be more serious about that, I guess. And
give it a college try.
Yeah, and even phones now, I think, are better handheld gaming consoles than they were. Because for the longest time, it was like Candy Crush and Angry Birds and like all these fucking mobile games, which Plants vs. Zombies, which to me, like, there was a very small window of time when mobile gaming was like
big,
good. And then it was like, wait a minute, everything's free to play and jammed with fucking ads and microtransactions, and it just became a shit show. But I think it's getting better now, especially, I don't know if this is an Android thing, but Netflix is doing games now.
Yeah.
Not like making them, but publishing them. So you can get games on your iPhone for free if you have Netflix. So like I have sitting on my phone right now that I haven't played yet, like that 12 minutes game, the indie one from a couple of years ago, just for free because it's a Netflix thing.
Oh.
The other indie game, I played the first one on the Switch called Oxenfree. Mm. The sequel to it, which came out this year, launched day one. Wait, through Netflix too.
You can just where? How do you play? What do you use to control your phone? You're saying?
Yeah, some of the games I think if you hooked up like a backbone, the like controller that you plug the phone into kind of thing, you could use it with that. But most of them are just like basically just touchscreen versions.
Mm.
So it's not like every game's gonna be able to do it, but like they are starting to put like some of these smaller kind of games onto phones and through Netflix, which is like a neat thing. So I know we've been all over the place here, but handheld gaming, I like it. I enjoy it. I wish Sony would take another swing.
You know what's interesting?
It's interesting to see where it's going.
You know what's interesting about the phrase, like, giving it a college try, is that most college tries are, like, kind of not good tries. Kind of like a weak try, you know? Like, why do people even use that? Like, who in college is, like, giving it a hard, like, most people are just kind of, like, chilling, you know? But also, what I was going to say last thing is, like, what's insane, I know we talked about how Nintendo basically has like a fucking monopoly on the handheld business. 154 million is their number one, and the next system from a different brand is 82 million.
Mm-hmm.
So like they're like almost doubling up on any other. It's wild.
Yeah, that's just one. The DS. Even well, I'm actually surprised. Honestly, the 3DS is as low as it is.
If Nintendo is gonna make the right decision, they're gonna make a new handheld system like the Switch 2 or whatever they're gonna call it, and they're gonna fucking put everything they have into it and make it like exceptional. They gotta.
I would venture a guess that Nintendo's next thing, because they're the only ones that do different shit consistently.
Because
it's like PS1 to PS2 was just sort of like an evolution. 2 to 3 was the same thing. 3 to 4, like 4 to 5. Like they're all in line with each other. Whereas like the NES to the SNES is basically the same. But then you get to the N64, which is like 3D and a whole different fucking thing, which then gets to GameCube, which is a whole different kind of ballpark. And then eventually you get to the Wii, which was when Nintendo was like, we're going off to do weirdo shit now.
Bro, Wii was so sick. Love the Wii.
And then you get like the Wii U, which was like a flop commercially, even though there are like objectively a lot of really good games on it.
Wasn't the Wii U basically like just like basically what the PS4 Pro was to the PS4, where it was kind of just like an updated version, a newer, kind of better graphics, whatever?
It was kind of like the Wii, but
because you can play all the Wii games on it, right?
Because, yeah, like, and the Wii remotes and everything work with it. So it's weird because it's kind of a half step of, like, still the Wii, but it wanted to be the Switch with, like, the game tablet thing.
Oh, yeah, I used to have that.
That was, like, the Wii U's whole thing was, like, we've got this tablet thing. So it's, like, it was kind of weird where it was, like, the Wii 2.0, but also, like, the proto-Switch kind of thing. So it was, like, this weird half step.
They're like, let's see how this goes.
Yeah, and then obviously you get the Switch. I think the Switch has been so successful that they would be stupid to, like,
let go of that idea?
Let that go and be like, hey, we're doing either, like, let's say another version of a DS or another version of, like, a straight-up console. Of those two outcomes, I would rather see them do a straight-up console. If they double down and, like, we're making, like, a PS5 level, like that caliber of a console, that to me would be more interesting than handheld.
Why wouldn't it make any sense?
All their games, like their exclusives, don't need that power.
This is the other thing.
But the question would be like, if they were to make a completely new thing, then like moving forward, they would make games exclusive for their new flagship console that is higher power that can't be handled on their old devices. You know what I'm saying? Like how the PS. Like how
Mario, Link.
No, but I'm saying new games. I'm saying obviously old games. Like it would be unnecessary to make a new flagship if you're only gonna play older games. But like they would, I'm assuming, have a certain period where they would just design new games that were exclusive, just like how they make PS5 exclusives that wouldn't run well.
But that would run counter to their whole image, I think.
Well, yeah, they're also Nintendo's not necessarily like the flashy Sony AAA. The Last of Us or Spider-Man or God, like, that's not their thing. Their games are huge and sell better than anybody else's, but it's a different like
vibe.
It's a different can of worms.
I think ultimately their best move would be to take the Switch and just try to fix all the problems that people had with it and make and just like basically buff it up, make it the most up-to-date version you can, and like perfect what you had with the Switch because it was amazingly successful.
Yeah.
So just take that core idea and just try to make it as good as possible. Like, fix the fucking Joy Drift or whatever. Mm-hmm. So maybe bad, make bro. Maybe make like the actual. I mean, obviously have higher resolution, better frame rates, just kind of newer, up to date technology. I feel like if they did that and they just basically did what the PS4 to PS5 did, where it just like buff it up and make it just overall cleaner and better, then it would blow up.
That's I assume what they're going to do, because to me it's like, again, to abandon the Switch thing when it's been this successful would be weird. Plus, I think it's not that Nintendo doesn't. I mean, we just said with the DS being able to play like Game Boy Advance fucking cartridges, but like to abandon to like make a new thing and not have it be backwards compatible. I mean, I guess even if they did it like straight up console, it could still be backwards compatible. But to me, it's like whatever they do next, it's like if they come out with a new thing and it's like Tears of the Kingdom doesn't work on the new thing, like that's gonna be the dumbest
they're not gonna do that
thing ever. Whereas to come out and be like, hey, it's a Switch, but like. Better power, the handheld, like it looks better in handheld. It's a better, you know, 4K whatever screen or like, you know.
That would be insane. Whatever
the
fuck cool.
And all that shit. The Joy-Cons are better and aren't these fucking things that fall apart.
But at the same time, I feel like even though it wouldn't make sense for them to make exclusive games that wouldn't be, you know what I'm saying? Like what you were saying about it being stupid, a stupid idea. I feel like they also can't go the complete other way of having like no new, you know what I'm saying? Because like if they have like a new console, or not a new console, new hand, like the Switch 2.
Yeah.
But they don't. On launch, have like Switch 2 made for the Switch 2 games.
Yeah.
Like, so for example, if PS4 came out and it's like, we don't really have any games made for the PS4, just play PS3 games. Like, why the fuck did I even buy this thing? So they have to be like a balance of like, you know, making some new shit, but also allowing the old stuff.
Yeah, and that's the thing where it's got to be backwards compatible because the people, you know, the five people on Earth who don't have a Switch right now, you want them to be able to buy a Switch 2 and be like, Mark's one of them. You want them to be able to buy a Switch 2 and be able to buy Breath of the Wild, Mario Odyssey, Tears of the Kingdom, Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. Like, you want them to be able to buy that shit day one. I imagine if I were a betting man, the fact that it's taken this long to get a new 3D Mario, specifically an Odyssey 2, because I feel like, I know, again, Mario is very, like, the 3D Mario's, like, you only got one 64, you only got one Sunshine. Galaxy was the kind of outlier where you got two Galaxy games. I think a Odyssey 2...
Is inevitable.
Like, I unless they have a completely different idea that they just want to do another 3D Mario game, but not the, like, hat swapping mechanic. I think that's almost a shoe-in as the launch game, in quotes.
Safe.
Because the fact that Tears of the Kingdom came out already, like, you've already blown that load. There's not really much else you could do for a Switch 2 that would draw. I mean, it's going to sell anyways, but, like,
completely
you would need, like, the Metroid Prime 4, a Mario Kart 9, a Odyssey 2. Like, you would need some big deal thing to, like, launch it with.
The Switch is just so fun. It is. It's so fun. Like, even games like Mario Tennis. I love Mario Tennis. Mario Tennis, Mario Party is pretty fun, too. Mm-hmm. Mario Kart, I love.
Smash, of course.
Super Smash Brothers, of course, yeah.
But, yeah, anyways, handheld console.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna get that $25 thing that has 2,000 games on it already, like the emulator thing.
Yeah, I have because cool. I might have been a different one, but I just want to look at the reviews because when I see some of those things, the fact that they're so cheap,
sure,
gives me pause. But at the same time, I'm also like, well, if it's shit for $25, it's like, what do I fucking care if it falls apart?
I mean, I listened to this whole like couple minute review, and this guy was saying like he thought it was gonna be shit, but it's actually legit. And
yeah,
there's a lot of comments on it and like good reviews, so I'm like, maybe anyways,
maybe perhaps.
Cool. I'm thirsty.
And we're back. So my topic's a little specific, I guess. And I've heard that not everyone does this, and like, there are different, like, levels to how people conceptualize this. And it's going to make sense in the second one, actually say what I'm talking about. How do you guys sort of link your music to your sort of memories? Do you like link? Do you remember songs based on who showed you the song? Do you remember songs based on sort of a prominent experience listening to the song?
I can start, I guess.
If you want to start, I can sort of go on for a little bit if you want to think.
Sure.
So I was talking with somebody recently, and they were saying how they personally remember a song. I guess they a lot of people introduce songs to them. They remember a majority of their songs based on who introduced it to them.
Okay.
And they are unable to enjoy a song. Like, they were basically saying that their enjoyment of the song is directly related to the quality of their relationship with the person who introduced it to them. So if, for example, I introduced you to Coldplay and then suddenly we had a falling out, or maybe not suddenly, but we had a falling out, he wouldn't be able to listen to Coldplay anymore, kind of thing.
Well, I know that that's a common thing with breakups and stuff, of like, if your significant other was like a huge, like, okay, let's say the guy's like really big into like Aerosmith or whatever.
Okay.
And he made the girl listen to it all the time, and they listened to it in the car, and then mm-hmm. they dated for years, and then it didn't work out. She would never want to ever hear Aerosmith again, just because of the bad memories, I guess.
Yeah.
Or like the hurt, like it kind of hurts to look back at, But so I think it's more of like a, because of the relationship ending, as opposed mm-hmm. to like the quality of the relationship back then.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying.
So I don't think.
So are you saying just for music that, like, they introduced them to? Because this person went on to say, not just music that they introduced me to, but music that we sort of shared.
Mm.
Kind of like, I have memories before this person.
Okay, but what if, what I'm saying are they basing it off of where they're at with the relationship now?
In the present day.
Oh, well then to me that has nothing to do with that's just them correlating. Yeah, that's just them basically like connecting the music with that person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but to me, I don't really think of it like that. I don't think of, this person showed me that, or this person. To me, I think about it as like a stage of my life. So, for example, like, kind of like grade 6 to 8, like pre-high school time, I listened to a fuck ton of a Radioactive, like just Imagine Dragons, like stuff that I listen to now and I think is like kind of corny, right?
Okay.
But no one really introduced it to me. I just kind of like stumbled upon it. It was very popular, obviously. It was on the radio and shit. So it wasn't that someone had introduced it to me, but I just associated with that kind of like preteen stage of my life. I think about it as like an age thing for myself, as opposed to a different person. Mm. And if I look back at it now, if I re-listen to a song that I loved when I was in grade 8, sometimes I may still like it, but most of the time my taste has changed, not because of any particular individual, but just because I've matured and grown, and like my personality has changed. Like I'm a completely different person now than I was like when I was in grade 8. So to me, it's that, as opposed to like me linking it with specific people. Mm-hmm. But I do understand that if I had someone who was in my life who was like super big into something,
yeah,
it would feel hard to get into that thing if things ended sour. You know, it would be hard for me to get into Aerosmith if the girl I was with was super into Aerosmith for years or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And even if I love Aerosmith, you know.
Yeah, part of it too is if you're an individual who doesn't really explore music, because you're someone who like explores music on their own pretty frequently.
I'd say so. Yeah.
So it would make more sense that your sort of conceptualization of your music is more so tied to
personal?
Yeah, like your stages in life.
That's
and
true.
And as you sort of grow up, you've sort of explored different avenues of music.
As opposed to like, that makes sense, because I even think about it with movies, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe if you're a super casual moviegoer, you're going to link certain movies you watched with who you watched it with back then. Because to you, you're not really into that movie.
Are we boring you? Sorry.
I'm sorry. But you know what I'm saying? Where like, maybe if you're a super casual movie watcher, you don't care enough about the movies to be like, oh, these kind of movies I watched when I was at this age. Like, you're just kind of like, I don't care too much about movies.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously you care about your relationships, and you link movies to your relationships, because it's not like movies aren't a personal thing to you.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, for example, like, I mostly link my movies with like, when I was this age, I was watching Spider-Man 3 every day. When I was this age, I was super into Pixar, and I was like self-discovering things for myself, as opposed to like, and I remember like growing up, most of the time, and I'm sure Matty can probably agree with the same thing, most of the people that I was around didn't watch as many movies as I did, or weren't as interested in them or talking about them, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, they loved movies, but like, I was obsessive over them. Like, most people around me weren't obsessing over it. They weren't like, they'd be like, you're weird for watching it fucking 7 times, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think it depends on how personal the thing is to you. Yeah. If it's kind of like disconnected from you, kind of, maybe you connect it with things that are more important to you, such mm-hmm. as your relationship.
So you're saying that just your final answer here is that your method is, it's like, for lack of a better word, like temporal.
Sure, but what's your overall question? Like, how do I think of music in the past? Like, how do I connect to music?
Like, yeah, like my overall question is like, what
method do I use?
What links? Mm-hmm. So, what aspect of like your memories do you link music to?
Yeah.
So this particular person, it was people. You're saying like
life stages,
like life stage, like time, kind of thing.
I'd say so for sure. Yeah. Like, I just remember, like, again, even like being like, I think I was like 9 or 10, and there was like, you know that song? What the hell is that song? It's like that house song.
Yeah. What's that called?
Yeah, I know what that is, but I forget what it's called.
Is that a Spanish one?
No, I don't think so. Is it?
It might be. I don't know. It might have like Spanish in it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I forget what that's called, but I know that song.
It's like something heart.
Mm.
But that
sort of, that's gonna annoy me the rest of the night.
But that song was on the radio for like years, mm-hmm. and I remember being in Egypt and listening to it, and being around that age of like probably like 8 or 9 or something. I don't remember the exact age, but I just remember that period of my life.
Yeah,
what connected to that song? Because my cousin was like, he does DJing now and shit. So and even back then, he had started doing it, and that was like a song that he was listening to back then. So yeah,
cool. Matthew,
I don't know. I feel like it's kind of both. In terms of like times and place and people, like there are songs sort of that make me think of people, specifically like my dad. Like a lot of the rock and roll stuff I listen to, I think about like my dad,
you know,
him being the one that showed it to me, kind of thing.
You know why I think I don't link it is because my family, my parents are all into Arabic music. And my brother and I were never like super close growing up, so we never really like spent so much time together talking about music or movies or whatever. So I don't really have people super close to me that I grew up with. So I don't really link it because I wasn't so into music as when I was younger that I'd talk to people about it and I'd have connections to people with it. It was just like a personal thing for me. But like your dad like being your avenue into rock and roll and like, you know, loving it through him.
Yeah.
That to me makes sense to link that.
Yeah, and even just the fact that he plays guitar and just, you know, sits in front of the TV in the living room like with his freaking guitar in his lap just like playing shit every day constantly kind of thing. It's like it's not like when I'm actively sitting listening to like a Rush song, I'm like my dad, but like there is that like tether there in some way.
Yeah.
But other than him, there's not too many people that I can even really think of
so,
that I would tie
like
with music and memories and that kind of stuff. But there are like a bunch of examples of times and places for me.
I see. So there's no song between the two of you. There's no song where you think your enjoyment of it would be influenced by your relationship to a particular person.
Well, Varsh and I, there's one song that she likes that she played for me one time that I really like. And that's an example, I guess, of like a song I like because of her and I only ever would have found because of her. Mm-hmm. So like that specific song, for example, makes me think of her.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Valentine by, I forget who it's by.
Dude, how am I supposed to start up the song, dude?
Machine Gun Kelly. Oh, God, yeah, I don't know, man.
That's such a fucking...
Yeah, honestly, put that in Google. Put that in
Machine Gun Kelly. Who's Laufey? Whoever the fuck that artist is. That lady with the very nice song, Valentine.
Okay.
I'm not playing it because I won't risk issues like last time. Yes. Maybe I'll play it for you guys after. Maybe listen to it later. But like that song, for example, I tie to Varsh. Mm-hmm. So like in that sense, you know, that's an example of somebody, I guess, that like I have memories and feelings and thoughts and shit attached to with the song. But yeah, I think it is just more so memories for me because it's like I found a lot of rock and roll songs, aside from my dad, through the Rock Band and Guitar Hero games.
Oh, yeah.
And so it's like there are songs that I hear, especially some of the stuff that's maybe like slightly newer rock and roll that like my dad wouldn't give a shit about. Like when I hear, I don't know, When You Were Young or whatever by like the Killers, immediately like that puts me back in that, like, I remember every day in, you know, elementary school when me, Michaela, Caden, and my brother would get picked up in like grade 3 or 4 or whatever. The four of us would all come back to my house and we'd be in the basement playing Rock Band for like hours, because we'd add like the drum set and a mic and a couple guitars. So, you know, somebody was guitar, somebody was bass. Like, and there's so many songs from those games that when I hear them put me back at that time. Or the other one is more like an album, is it's a U2 album. I forget what it's called, but it's the one where it's like the black and white cover
and them standing there with like the back.
It's like the one where it's like the dude's torso and the other dude hugging him.
That's the one with that Apple CarPlay that like you,
that's the one that they like automatically threw onto like every iPhone. And people at the time were like, why are you putting an album on my phone? Yes, but like that's a bunch of those songs. When that album first came out, I really loved it, and I still love some of the songs from it. And that was the album that like I would be sitting in my basement playing fucking Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare on like the PS3 and whatever. And so like that's, that album puts me in that time frame or like that headspace of like, yeah, I remember being a freaking like late elementary, early high school student playing that album while playing that specific game, and like that sort of like moment in time kind of thing. So yeah, I guess to me it's just, it's music and memories is more of a time, it's, well, it's both, like I said, it's a time and place thing and it's a person thing. I guess, because I also like, I don't, a song like Pretty Woman, for example, was like one of my grandma's favorite songs.
Pretty Woman.
Yeah.
Roy Orbison.
So it's like that was one of her favorite songs, and because she liked that movie.
Like
more so the movie, I think, than even the song itself. And maybe that's what it even is. I think, because I know she liked that movie, so maybe it's more even the movie itself than the song. But because that song's in the movie, hearing it makes me think of her kind of thing. So that's even more of like a tangential connection where it's like, it's not even the song itself. It's the way the song ties to this thing she liked, which ties to her, and then, you know, back around to me kind of thing. So that's almost more of like a two-step connection.
Yeah, I think people like the person I was referencing are definitely in the minority of, because like it kind of like, it doesn't make any sense to me, to be honest with you,
about
like,
not listening to stuff,
about not listening to stuff, but just like tethering all your music to a person. Like, well, it doesn't
I guess it depends.
It makes sense for it to be memories.
But if
to
you
me.
And like if you and a significant, like a romantic partner, discovered a band together when you like first got together, and then went through their whole discography and became fans and saw them on tour, like, and then broke up with that person, I could see you tying that band and their music to and the memories with
that
person.
That's such a specific scenario, though. I feel like more times than not, if you like a band and if you happen to discover it with someone, you're still going to listen to those songs on your own, and you'll develop memories independent of that person. Like, it only makes sense.
Not necessarily. Like,
not
to
necessarily,
me,
but
to me,
I,
if you start getting into a musical artist or band before you met them, and it gets stronger when you met them, you may still listen to it. But if you started listening, if it was like one of those things where like, oh, that was our band, or that was something that we started doing at the same time or listening to at the same time, it may be impossible for you to disconnect it.
Potentially.
I even have that experience now of like,
can you give an example?
So like, for example, with my ex, she loved listening to ABBA all the time. And now I like ABBA a lot. But now I just can't. I don't like listening to ABBA much anymore, because it's just like, it just feels like it was something where I've always, you know, liked ABBA just fine. Mm-hmm. But like, we were listening to it all the time when we were together, which to me just, I don't know, feels weird.
That makes sense. But the point I'm trying to make is, if it's an artist that you like and you will, that you engage with individually, then it makes it less probable that you're going to link it so tightly with this person. Because you have enjoyment with it outside of this person.
Yeah, but for me, I had enjoyment with ABBA like I love Dancing Queen.
That seems like so casual. Like your enjoyment of ABBA seemed so.
You're saying I'm not deeply. I don't deeply care about ABBA. Yeah.
But I think what you're saying too is a different case too, where you're more saying like, Rush is my favorite band ever. If I got together with Varsha and she was also like, I really like Rush too, and then it was this like bonding thing for us, and then her and I stopped seeing each other kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Like, I get what you're saying of like, well, you liked Rush before this person and with this person, so there's a very good chance you'll like it still after, mm-hmm, kind of thing. But so that to me, I get what you're saying, but that is also just like to me a different scenario.
Yeah.
Whereas to me, the scenario of like, again, this Valentine's song with Varsha and I consider that her like and I our song in quotes kind of thing. So to me, it's like,
I found it, dude.
What's it called?
Oh no, the copyright's gonna be mad.
Is this a cover or is this the original?
No, this is it. All right. Oh boy.
I swear this is a Spanish song. This is a cover. Listen.
It might be Portuguese.
No, that's Portuguese, listen, listen. Yeah.
She said done. There's some things I've never done.
Maybe it is. It's definitely got that Spanish vibe or something. Good job, Spotify.
It's called Stereo Love. I was trying to think of a word.
Stereo Love. That's
and then I just remembered like stereo, and then I searched it up and it was up there.
That's true. It is Stereo Love.
So catchy, dude. Imagine you're on like PCP and you're dancing in a club and you're sweating.
Honestly, if clubs played music just like,
dude,
that,
I'd love that.
Purely,
dude.
Like, mm-hmm, I would be like
fucking out there just
vibing in the club, bro. I'm telling you,
we gotta cut all that.
Yeah. I might throw in 5 seconds of it at the end before the outro. Yeah, because that'll be a good little end card there. So anyways, but yeah, what you're saying to me makes sense, but that in and of itself is a different
case. That's the greatest song of all time. I love that song, genuinely. I'm going to save that
song.
It's
so good.
I gotta add that to Varsha and I's shit. Yeah, but so that's what I'm saying, where it's like that Valentine's song for Varsha and I, yeah, God forbid if her and I stopped seeing each other, like that fucking song is over for me.
That's what I'm saying.
Because it's not a song I knew beforehand, like you're saying.
And it's not a song that you enjoy individually.
It's a song that I found because of her.
Do you ever listen to it without her?
Let me make it even
from time to time, but not really. Yeah. It is like a with her kind of thing. So to me, it's like it'll
be hard.
Again, it's our song in quotes. Mm-hmm. That it's like I tie it to her and memories of being with her. Mm-hmm. So if anything went wrong, kind of thing, and we weren't together anymore,
then
that fucking song is over for me.
And I honestly think, to an even looser extent, I think that if you, for example, are with someone for 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
From the age of 20 to 21, and now you're like 24 or 25, and you think back to that 20 to 21 range, and there was a band that you started listening to that year, that same year that you started dating this person, and things ended really sour, for example, even if it wasn't their band, or even if it wasn't really directly connected to them, the fact that you fell in love with this band the same time you fell in love with this person, and then things ended sour with that person, you may look back at that time like, I just want to like forget about that entire year, because you were so strongly linked to that person that whole year that you might not even want to look at that time period for music for you anymore. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I hear that.
So it might not even be like a particular song or a genre of music. It may just be like specific songs that you listen to or artists that you started really liking around that time. You might not want to listen to them much anymore, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I also think it's like, I have no idea what else I'm going to say. Yeah, it's interesting. Also, I was going to say, for me personally, like, again, I don't link it with any people, but I feel like my tastes change so radically, and very quickly as well. So like it's like an extreme change and it's pretty quick. Like just a couple of years ago, I'll go to my Spotify, because I started Spotify in 2018 or something. I go back to 2018, 2019, and like most of a lot of the shit I don't even want to listen to anymore. I just like, I loved it back then, but to me now I just like, I don't like it much anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that sometimes it's hard to distinguish between why I stopped listening to it. Like, was it because, you know, it was like I wasn't as happy during that time? Was it because my taste just naturally changed? I assume it's the latter, but like, I'd say, for example, like with the ABBA thing, it could be that I just don't like ABBA much anymore, or it could be tied with the person, or it could be a combination of both. In that case, I feel like it is tied to the person, but it could be a mixture of things. And I feel like most of the time it is. Like, when is an answer in life like very like straightforward, black and white? Like, this is the reason. Mm. I feel like usually it's like a, whether you like it or not, it's like a, it's like a mixture of shit in your life.
Yeah, shut up.
Yeah, shut up.
We need to go to, we need to go to a club together, I think.
Do we?
It'd be great.
I think we need to, I think we need to experience the club together.
Mm. Here we go. Here we go.
At the fucking club, dude.
Do you disagree though?
You got a couple buttons down and your chest is out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You disagree though?
You know what I mean? I don't disagree.
Like,
and also,
we should try like a true actual club together.
Dude, we should wear like button up shirts that are like silk.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like the silky, like velvety,
like a satin almost.
Satin, bright, like just red.
Yeah.
Mm. Red or bright blue.
Mm-hmm.
Button halfway down, so open. You have your chest hair out,
mm-hmm.
and you have a drink in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
Would you have a drink?
Maybe
in
you
your
have
hand?
Your hair spiked up. You got mm-hmm. some sunglasses mm-hmm. in your.
Would you have a drink in your hand? Would you drink a porn star maybe?
Sure.
Mojito.
I think we would have to have a few porn stars before we go to this club.
Dude, that would honestly, that sounds like so much fun.
I feel like we've talked for years about how much we don't like
clubs.
No,
but it's, to me, it's because of
honestly,
the way... I've never been to clubs, but to me, it's how it's portrayed in media and shit. It's like just like...
I've had a revelation that I like to talk about off air.
Okay, cool.
But I get... But that is kind of... Not that I have the most experience with clubs, but the handful of ones I have been to, like, it is more that where it's like... Don't get me wrong. If it was what you guys were saying... My perfect dream world club is basically just... Like
a Dave and Buster's.
No, it's like, you know, like sometimes we go to like a bar or a restaurant where like the music's too fucking loud. Mm. And that's different because it's like I'm sitting and eating and I want to be whatever. But to me, it's like my dream club is basically just a bar with loud music, but not like
I've been to
club
it.
House music or it. Trap music
I've
or
been
fucking,
to
you know, whatever.
Mm.
Where?
In Toronto, downtown Toronto.
Which one? Name the club.
I think it's called
Cruise.
Petty Cash.
Is that actually a thing?
Yeah.
Petty Cash.
I just guessed. What I was going to say is I feel like there could be an environment where that's fun in terms of like, imagine being at a place where you have like a sit down area where mm-hmm. you can order nice food, bar food, whatever. And it's kind of like on the side, but then you have to go through a door or a hallway and that leads to a big dance floor.
Well, this place, Petty Cash, is like a restaurant before like the hours of club. And then once it's like later, they like close like the kitchen and everything, and it becomes like a club, but it's still like the restaurant area. But
dude,
like,
wow.
You know what I'm saying? And they have like a huge
Petty
bar.
Cash?
You never went, I don't think.
Where were we for
Varsha's
thing?
That was not
Toronto.
Petty Cash. That was near Petty Cash.
But we were at that place that it was like a bar downstairs, and then you guys left and we went upstairs.
Maybe did we?
And
did
it
we
was,
go to Petty Cash for a little bit? We went
to a place where like we sat and
it was near
we left.
Me and you left. I remember it was near Petty Cash though.
And then there was that video game bar that we went to.
Yeah.
Yes.
Pre-play.
Yeah, that was fucking. Yeah. I love that shit.
Anyways.
But yeah, so I don't know. Music memories.
Music fun, clubs, and memories.
It is now midnight. 10 after midnight.
Ten after midnight.
So we're gonna get the hell out of here.
Yeah, the hell. I gotta be at work at 9 o'clock tomorrow.
All right, 9:30. There we go.
Well, anyways, this has been another episode. The 30th. Whoa. Episode.
Oh my god! How crazy is? Okay, wait. Let's just
off air.
Please like, share, subscribe. Find us. You know. By the way, we lost one subscriber at the time of recording this.
We did.
What's up with that?
Yeah.
What was that about?
Come back to us, please.
Come back to us, please.
You will be punished.
Patrick, do you have anything to get off your chest before we get out? What you just said? You had something.
Not on air.
Okay. Oh, that also wasn't on air?
All
off
air.
Two off air things.
Okay.
Tease.
Sorry, guys.
Bye bye, everybody.
Goodbye, folks.